views and opinions expressed in this program are those of the participants and do not necessarily reflect the views of BronxNet or the program underwriters.
Hello and welcome to Open BxRx, BronxNet's special coverage providing you the latest information, resources, services, and community efforts taking place locally here in the Bronx and virtually during the pandemic. I'm your host, Sonyi Lopez, and today is Tuesday, March 16th. Coming up, Assemblymember and candidate for Borough President Nathalia Fernandez joins us to discuss how legislators are fighting for vaccine equity in our communities. Then, March is Colon Cancer Awareness Month. A Montefiore doctor shares information, prevention, and the importance of early detection of this health condition. After that, One Freedom for All places our Bronx youth in the forefront of the most pressing issues in our community, and they're facing an imminent closure of their space. Learn how you can support later on. And BxArts Factory invites you to create art from the comfort of your home through their Art Time series in collaboration with BronxNet. Stay tuned to find out more. So please, stick around. Open BxRx starts now. Welcome to Open BxRx on BronxNet. I'm your host, Sonyi Lopez, inviting you to get social with us at BronxNet TV on Instagram and Twitter and BronxNet Community Television on Facebook. Following a letter from legislators regarding Bronx vaccination disparities, the State Department of Health vowed to work with the New York City Department of Health to ensure that this inequity is immediately addressed. What has changed? What's coming up? One of those legislators who signed for vaccine equity in our borough is Assemblymember Nathalia Fernandez, and she's also a candidate for borough president here in the Bronx. She's joining us here today to discuss. Welcome, Assemblymember Fernandez. Thank you so much for joining us today.
Good afternoon. Thank you so much for having me.
Of course. So let's start with the basics. You know, the issue here is vaccine equity and equity in general. What were some of the issues you saw in our community, and what exactly was happening that you thought needed to be, or an alarm needed to be rang?
Absolutely. Well, looking at the numbers that were, you know, at the height of the pandemic throughout the summer and even now, certain areas in the Bronx, especially in Black and Brown communities, had high infection rates, high death rates. So when we started talking about the vaccine and, you know, where it needed to be distributed, these areas were certainly a priority for many. But still, you know, with the number of vaccination sites that were brought here to the Bronx, it wasn't enough. And a lot of us feel that, you know, since we are the borough that overall has the highest infection rate, overall has a high death rate, we needed to be very practical in where we're going and how we're getting this vaccine out to the people.
Thank you, Assemblymember. Now, about this letter that you and other legislators signed recently and delivered to Governor Cuomo, what were some of the demands in the letter made by you and other legislators?
Well, early on, the demand was get us a mass vaccine site. And as soon as the governor and, you know, the mayor said that we're going to get vaccines, I produced a list of locations all over the borough that were of size, that were near public transportation, to give them a heads up or at least a little bit of help as to where to look to, where to go, knowing that these were large locations. We were very happy to hear that Yankee Stadium, which was one of my suggestions on the list, became a mass vaccine site, but that still presented an issue with a lot of members in my area here in the North Bronx that are seniors that couldn't travel, that were afraid to travel down to to Yankee Stadium. So, and speaking of equity, you know, we need to hit all the big areas in the Bronx. And my partners in government, we signed the letter to get a North Bronx vaccine site, as Yankee Stadium is in the South Bronx. And we're happy that we did see the mayor move and now put a vaccine site in Co-op City, which is one of the most heavily dense neighborhoods in the Bronx. But even that still is not enough. You know, it's great that we have in Co-op City. It's absolutely needed there. But in the Northeast Bronx, where there's still, you know, deserts of vaccine information or locations, we need to make sure that we're hitting all areas and not leaving anybody out.
Absolutely. And I'm glad that you brought up the access as well, Assemblymember. As you said, you know, there are a lot of seniors that can physically access these locations and vaccination sites like 161 and Yankee Stadium. Can you tell us about the new in-home Johnson & Johnson vaccinations and who qualifies for them and how they can inquire and sign up for this new program?
Yes, well, I do have all this information on my website right now. So I encourage everyone, please visit Fernandez2021.com. And we have all the updated information as it's coming out from the state and the city about the vaccines that are available. And the Johnson & Johnson one is part of a program that's, you know, giving sign up and making your appointment. It can provide door-to-door service of giving the vaccine right in your home. This vaccine doesn't need to be refrigerated at low temperatures, sub-zero temperatures, like the other ones, Pfizer and Moderna. So it does make it a lot easier to get around with it and get it out quicker to the people. But I believe now today, the governor announced that eligibility opened up to 60 and older, not only 65 and older, for older New Yorkers to go get the vaccine.
Got it. And that's for the in-home Johnson & Johnson, that one shot that we've been talking about recently. It's not the two shot.
Yes, that one's a one shot. That is the difference. And, you know, people are doing the research, and I absolutely encourage you to do the research. You know, the Pfizer and Moderna have been said to be more effective, but this one still is very helpful and very needed for those that, you know, are less compromised.
Thank you, Assemblymember. And since we have you here, President Biden's new American Rescue Plan does include the stimulus checks for eligible Americans, as we know, and it also includes funding vaccinations and supporting struggling communities. Can you help us break down where the $1.9 trillion are going specifically and how this plan will benefit Bronxites in particular?
Well, the $1.9 trillion is for the whole country. So New York State is receiving $12 billion of that. And that $12 billion, we are in discussion now, you know, in the Assembly and the Senate, with the governor deciphering how we can properly disseminate the $12 billion here in the state. So we know that there's assistance needed in our healthcare system, making sure that we are providing safe staffing to patients that, you know, that's going to be a need for the hospitals to be able to keep, you know, staff on payroll to do all these shifts. We know that we need assistance with the food shortage that's here in the state. You know, many people are still not working. Our pantries are being, there's longer lines than ever at our food pantry. So we got to do everything to make sure that they're fully funded and stocked to be able to handle the amount of outreach they've been getting. We also know that there will be a component to make sure that this vaccine is getting to our neighborhood. So there's been discussion about mobile units. As, you know, we see our flu shot distribution every year, and they're doing pop-ups in the park. CVS has it. You can go to your doctor's office, and there's events, you know, to get your flu shot. So we want to see that same effort with the vaccine. But it's all still to be determined. You know, we are in the process now in conference with our members to really try to make sure that we are giving as much aid to all the areas that need help right now.
Something else I wanted to bring up, Assemblymember, is the fact that, you know, the equity also comes in the form of having access to the locations, but it also comes in the form of language access. I've seen a lot of issues with people not understanding Spanish and, you know, coming up and creating a vaccine hub in, let's say, in Alto Manhattan, in the Washington Heights. And then people come and they're not understood. Can you also talk about how, you know, you and other legislators are also ensuring that these folks are helped in language access as well?
Absolutely. And a lot of the time that's with a piece of legislation, you know, an amendment into the legislation to make sure that these efforts are being distributed equitably, you know, with the language access, making sure that we have various language options. And that was a big problem early on, you know, when the sites first started, this Washington Heights site in particular, then it was in a location that we knew is predominantly Black and Brown. But when we saw who was receiving the vaccine, it was white New Yorkers from out of the neighborhood. So that means that we have a problem in reaching these communities and educating them, because we know, I'm sure many of us know people that are still having concerns, not trusting the vaccine, you know, wanting to wait to get it. But we need to give the facts. And that's what, you know, a lot of my legislator partners have been doing, holding forums. I've had a few, and, you know, sharing the information out there, but in people's language. So at least in my area, I've supported a grant that Bronx House Community Center is applying for, which I believe this $1 trillion, you know, a couple of the money will come to it to help provide educational outreach to various language speaking communities, you know, in Russian and Albanian and Arabic, Spanish, of course. But it's really important that we're giving all the facts to everybody in the way that they need it to be told to them.
Right. And how are you and other electeds ensuring that the first people being served are Bronxites? And like, is that being monitored now? You know, a lot of people coming in from outside of the borough, taking advantage of the vaccine being offered here.
Yes, now it's certainly being monitored. And unfortunately, and, you know, understanding that with the first day of everything and the start of new things, there might be some hiccups, there might be some, you know, areas that need improvements. And that's what happened even at the vaccine site of Bronx River Houses. I visited the one that the governor's office started right there in Bronx River Houses. And the first day of, you know, the shots to be administered, there was two lines into the building. So I'm like, why is there one line? What's this other line? And one line was the Bronx residents that were outreached by the NYCHA directors to say, okay, Bronx residents have first dibs on these vaccines, sign up and let's come. But then there was a glitch that Somos Care had put the link on their website, sign up for a vaccine at this location. So there were people that had registered online from everywhere coming to this one location. And then there were people that, you know, were from Bronx River Houses ready to take their vaccine. So those glitches have been cleared up. And, you know, it's very strict. If you are a Bronx resident coming to this Bronx vaccine location, you must show proof of residency and whatever else you have to. But those issues are being worked out. And we're really putting effort to make sure that the vaccines that come to a neighborhood in the Bronx are for the people in that neighborhood in the Bronx and just in the Bronx in general.
Assemblymember Fernandez, something else that I read is that your office was offering PCR testing as well. Can you just share more information on that and when you'll be offering it?
Absolutely. As much as we're trying to get the information out and get the access out to get the vaccine, it's still very important for Bronxites to frequently get tested until they do get the vaccine. It's, you know, important to know your status. We're trying to control the spread, and getting your test and knowing that status helps to do that. So my office will be offering free COVID testing on March 24th from 10 a.m. to 5 p.m. We welcome walk-ins. So if you are around, we're located at 2018 Williamsbridge Road, Bronx, New York, 10461. And you can also make an appointment if you want to plan your visit by calling us at 718-409-0109.
Thank you so much, Assemblymember Fernandez, for joining us today.
Thank you so much.
Again, for more information on your nearest vaccination site and check your eligibility, make an appointment, and more, you can visit vaccinefinder.nyc.gov. We'll be right back with OpenBXRX.
Who's most at risk for coronavirus? People over 65, people with underlying medical conditions like heart disease, chronic lung disease, asthma, diabetes, people undergoing cancer treatment, and people with weakened immune systems. What should you do if you or a loved one is at higher risk? Avoid close contact with people. Avoid crowds. Stay home if you can. Wash your hands frequently. Learn more ways to protect yourself and others at coronavirus.gov.
While many of us are focused on COVID-19, this month is also important for recognizing an entirely different health condition impacting our most vulnerable, Colon Cancer Awareness Month. Joining us now to share more information is Dr. Edward Chu, Director of Albert Einstein Cancer Center and Vice President of Cancer Medicine at Montefiore Medicine. Welcome, doctors. Thank you so much for joining us today.
Well, thanks so much for having me today.
Of course. We are discussing a very important topic, no, doctor. The first thing I wanted to ask is how many people in the U.S. and more specifically in the Bronx are affected by colon cancer? And of course, why is it so important to raise awareness?
Well, you know, colorectal cancer is a major public health problem, you know, here in the United States and globally. So in 2021, there will be about 150,000 new cases of colorectal cancer diagnosed. And it's associated with about 52,000-53,000 deaths per year. Globally, worldwide, there'll be about 1.2, 1.3 million cases of colon cancer diagnosed. and associated with about 600,000 deaths. Wow. So, you know, in the United States and worldwide, it's the second leading cause of cancer deaths. So that's why it really is such a significant problem, even though if you look at the overall survival rates of colon cancer over the last 15 to 20 years, we've seen a pretty significant reduction in deaths, overall deaths resulting from colon cancer. But what's of concern is that we're seeing now an increased incidence of colon cancer presenting at an earlier age, and that earlier age under the age of 45 and 50, both colon and in particular rectal cancer. Now, closer to home, actually here in the state of New York, there will be about 9,000 new cases of colon cancer diagnosed. So in terms of, you know, where we rank in the United States, you know, we're the number four state with respect to the number of colon cancer patients diagnosed. And even closer to home, here in the Bronx, you know, we see about 550 to 600 new cases of colon cancer each year.
Wow. Thank you so
much. In the state of New York, it's about 9,000 new cases.
These are some very alarming numbers, Doctor. Thank you so much for sharing. Out of curiosity, why are cases surging and why are they projected to surge so high in this year?
Well, so actually the number of cases has been holding steady at around 145 to 150,000 cases. I think the number that's most alarming to those of us who've been in this field for a long time, and I've been in this field for 30 plus years, is the increasing incidence of the younger population. So, you know, so for a long time, it was felt that the vast majority of colon cancer was diagnosed when patients were in their 60s and 70s. So kind of an older person's disease. But again, as I said, we're now seeing an increasing incidence of colon cancer presenting in the late 30s and early 40s, certainly under the age of 50.
And Doctor, why does colon cancer affect Black and Hispanic people at higher rates? What research has been done regarding this phenomenon, really?
Yeah, so most of the research that's being done has been kind of what's called the epidemiology. And in fact, our investigators here at the Albert Einstein Cancer Center and Montefiore have been looking at, you know, the incidence, the increasing incidence of what's called early onset colon cancer. And in particular in our Hispanic and African American patients. So by far and away, the large majority of the early onset colon cancer in our community, in the Bronx community, about 56, 57% are African Americans, mm-hmm. and another 35% are Hispanics. And it's interesting, the Hispanic patients are presenting in their mid to late 30s. Wow. So African Americans, usually they present in the late 30s, mid 40s. So that's why many years ago, the American Cancer Society recommended that even though for average risk individuals, that's all comers, mm-hmm. that colon cancer screening should start at the age of 50. Wow. For African Americans, the recommendation has been to start at the age of 45.
Got it. So normally, doctor, we hear, you know, what you just said, a colonoscopy should be done for the first time at 50 years old. But with this new data and all this research, now we should be getting it at 30 instead. Is that what you're saying, doctor?
No. So I think now the recommendation is for an average risk individual, colon cancer screening should start at the age of 45.
Okay.
If there's a family history of colon cancer, and especially if someone presents at a younger age, then it's usually 10 years before the earliest onset of colon cancer.
Okay, got it.
So perfect example. So yours truly has already had 6 colonoscopies done. Mm-hmm. My very first colonoscopy was done at the age of 28. And the reason for that is I had some symptoms, but also my mom's youngest brother presented with colon cancer when he was 38. And so if you take 10 years off of that, right, late 20s, and amazingly, that's when I actually started having some symptoms, some red blood in my stool. Fortunately, it turned out to be hemorrhoids, mm-hmm. but Having been from a family with a strong family history of colon cancer, because actually two of my uncles had colon cancer and unfortunately passed from the disease, and then being already involved in colon cancer research, obviously I was pretty focused on making sure that I didn't have colon cancer.
Absolutely. I think stressing the fact that family history is an important aspect of this early onset detection. No, doctor. Can you just emphasize the importance of early detection and also share the benefits of getting a colonoscopy?
So I think plain and simple, colon cancer screening saves lives. Mm-hmm. And that with colon cancer screening, we can identify the cause of colon cancer, which in the vast majority of cases is polyps. But also with colon cancer screening and specifically colonoscopy, which I think many of us, including myself, feel is the gold standard for colon cancer screening, we can, if there is colon cancer within the colorectal region throughout the whole large intestine, we can catch colon cancer at its earliest stages. Yeah. And so when caught at its earliest stage, we can cure 90% or more of the patients. Unfortunately, by the time the patients come to see me, the medical oncologist, you know, where we give systemic therapies to treat what's called stage 4 metastatic colon cancer, you know, even though we've now developed over the last 10 to 15 years much more effective treatments, it's still not easy to cure patients. So again, if we can catch colon cancer at its earliest stages, we can cure up to 90 to 95% of patients. So that's why I think it's really important, especially in the month of March, mm-hmm. where we're really trying to highlight the importance of colon cancer screening. And that's why, you know, shows like Bronx Net are so important to really get the word out as to why this is so important.
Dr. Chu, let's say someone's listening right now and they're not sure of the early onset symptoms. What are some of those symptoms that you can share with us?
So, you know, the classic symptoms are weight loss, fatigue, reduced appetite, some belly pain or cramps. You know, a classic symptom is a change in either the consistency of the stool, the bowel movement, or classically it's kind of pencil thin. Okay, it's not the kind of big bulky stool that one usually sees, but it's kind of very thin, okay, which would argue that there might be an obstruction in the colon. Or sometimes you can see a change in the color, and usually you might see blood, either red blood in the stool, and that's kind of what freaked me out when I saw red blood in my stool, right? Or sometimes what you can see is kind of what's called tarry black stools. So the stools are a very blackish color. But what's concerning, and this is why, again, colon cancer screening is so important, is because there are a lot of patients who will have absolutely no symptoms. Mm. And so that's kind of maybe one of the first myths about colon cancer is, oh, well, don't worry, I have no symptoms. And I can't tell you how many patients over the years I've seen who had absolutely no symptoms, right? Marines, for instance, who were in amazing shape. They were superstar athletes. Yet then by the time they present to me, had widespread metastatic disease. Wow. So that's why even with no symptoms, it's critically important to go get screened. And again, another myth, right, is that, well, I don't need to worry about colon cancer because there's no family history. Mm-hmm. Actually, the number one risk factor for colon cancer in up to 85% of the patients we see is age. Wow. And so again, that's why the vast majority of patients present after the age of 50, but now we're bringing it down to to greater than 45.
Right. Doctor, before we let you go, what are some preventative measures that we can take with either our diets and our lifestyles? Is there anything that we can do to prevent getting colon cancer?
Yeah, so diet, nutrition, critically important. So the things that kind of promote colon cancer, red meats, processed foods, processed meats, foods that are rich in fat and cream, and foods that have, you know, so unfortunately my 17-year-old son is a prime example, right? He doesn't eat green leafy vegetables, fruit, or fiber. Well, except maybe for watermelon. But for the most part, he doesn't like green leafy vegetables or fiber. And we know that diets that are rich in green leafy vegetables, fiber, and bran actually can significantly reduce the risk of colon cancer. Not smoking, refraining from alcohol also can reduce the risk. And we also know that physical activity is also very important. So patients who are inactive and who are obese, overweight, that also increases the risk. And interestingly, diabetes, when the sugar is out of control, also can contribute to increasing the risk of colon cancer.
Thank you so much, Dr. Chu, for sharing all this information with us. Before we go, how can people find out more and contact Montefiore to get their colon cancer screenings today?
Yeah, so people can go to www.montefiore.org, and then they can type in colon cancer screening. And in fact, we have patient navigators. And if you go to that website, there's a number that one can call and one can learn more about what our cancer center is offering in terms of screening, early detection, and we can also provide important educational materials.
Thank you so much, Dr. Chu, again, for joining us on Colon Cancer Awareness Month, March, to share more information.
Well, thanks so much for having me.
Again, Dr. Edward Chu is the director of Albert Einstein Cancer Center and VP of Cancer Medicine at Montefiore Medicine. We're taking a quick break here on OpenBXRx. We'll be right back. There's a special election on Tuesday, March 23rd, and if you live in any of these neighborhoods, you'll want to pay attention. Your councilman, Andrew Cohen, is now a judge, and there are five candidates looking to replace him. Whoever wins on March 23rd will join New York City's primary lawmaking body, making decisions that affect you, your family, your home, and even your workplace. Starting in 2021, New York City will use ranked choice voting in primary and special elections for local offices. Ranked choice voting simply means that voters can rank up to five candidates in order of preference instead of casting a vote for just one. You can still vote for just one candidate if you prefer. You can learn everything there is to know about the District 11 City Council race and the candidates by visiting ballotpedia.org and riverdalepress.com. Stay informed, and most importantly, make sure you mail your absentee ballot the day before Election Day on March 23rd, or safely head out to the polls to have your vote count and your voice heard. The youth is our future, and their leadership means everything in our communities. One Freedom for All places the youth in the forefront of the fight for education, food justice, environmental justice, and the end to the school-to-prison pipeline. Now the youth needs our help in keeping their work going. Joining us now to share more is Hector Gerardo, founder and executive director of One Freedom for All. Hector, thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you so much for having me. It's a pleasure to be here and a beautiful day. Today is a beautiful day to be out in the streets and doing some good work, you know.
Yes, it is beautiful. We finally got some warm weather out here. You know, it's cold outside, but it's feeling great. So Hector, to start, for those who are not familiar, can you tell us about One Freedom for All and your mission?
Yeah, you mentioned it a little bit in the introduction. So I'm, like you said before, I'm Hector Gerardo, the executive director of One Freedom for All. And One Freedom for All is a youth-led organization that it seeks to create a multi-generational youth-led movement to address the current unjust food system and provide healthy and accessible food options in our local food apartheid neighborhoods in the South Bronx. Our mission is to teach youth of color to identify and to stand on their own power while addressing food insecurity in the immediate communities. Youth activists use the tools of organizing, popular education, culture, and the arts to create grassroots systematic change to achieve food justice. That's what we do. I had to read it because sometimes it's better to go off of something. So basically we mobilize, what we say, our motto is educate, agitate, and organize. So we educate our young people, we agitate them around an issue that concerns them, and then we mobilize them and we organize them to create change in their communities around food justice, around food insecurity, especially because it's a direct connection to housing. It's a direct connection to mass incarceration. It's a direct connection to school to prison pipeline, because a lot of people don't know that the same foods that some prisons get is the same food that the DOE is feeding our young people. Not to say that the prisoners should get that type of food, but nobody should be able to be getting that type of food or whatever they give them for lunch. They should be getting, you know, nutritious food, and that's what we fight for. We started off, you know, in high schools throughout New York City, teaching young people about cooking, teaching young people about the systems of oppression. One of those systems is the broken food system in the South Bronx. That is one of the wealthiest, everybody know the saying, is one of the poorest county in the United States. And most of the food comes through Holmes Point. And they're not getting those healthy options. They're just getting the McDonald's. They're just getting, you know, all the crappy food that is cheap, because they make a value meal from McDonald's to be like $3. But if you buying a meal for your family, you got to spend $150 to buy something healthy. So that's what we fight for. That's what we teach our young people. It's not just about them and the work that they are doing. It's about the whole community and how can we come together in this pandemic that we understand has been hard in our communities, but we've been living through a pandemic before COVID-19. We've been living through police brutality. We've been living through housing unjust laws that they put out there for people to get evicted, for people not to get homes. So basically that's what we do as One Freedom, is bringing those issues to the forefront, but youth led.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Hector. It was an understatement for me to ask, you know, what are some of the services, but you do it all with the community and the youth involved. So it's a wonderful thing to have our youth in the forefront again. I wanted to ask, what type of changes and challenges has One Freedom faced due to the pandemic? As we know, you know, a lot of things have changed in our communities and organizations like yours.
Yeah. So one of the challenges is we loosen our space because of the pandemic. Funding is kind of hard to get. When you are a fairly new organization, we only been in legal, like, you know, through the IRS for only 4 years in 2017. So we've been doing, you know, the work out of pocket. Everything that we do is out of pocket. My deputy director and myself, we just do everything ourselves. So now it's time to ask the community. You know, we always preaching, you know, village. It takes a village to raise a child. So we ask in our village to be able to raise our child, and it's bringing communities, not just services, but community actions, mobilizing actions that they can take, not just, you know, protests in the street, but like, how can you fix a street light? Right now in Webster, where we are right now, there's a intersection that needs a traffic light. So now we're organizing our young people. So we can, we are teaching them how to organize a campaign, how to build a campaign from the ground up, and to fix and bring a traffic light to that intersection. So that's some of the things that we do in our organization. And we're facing, you know, now the we might close in a few months, like by the end of March or April, because we finesse, like we're trying to work it out with the landlord so we can get an extra month. But he's been working with us, but we still need people to help out. And that's one of the biggest challenges that we face is, you know, fundraising. And we haven't been able to fundraise because we can't gather a lot of people in one place. And everything that we do is virtual, even though it's, you know, everything is virtual now, like this interview, but nothing beats that face-to-face and understanding the work that we do and seeing the work that we do firsthand with an office and having the young people here because we teach not just community organizing, but we do cooking classes. Right now we're gonna start teaching coding. We're gonna do a coding class so young people can learn how to, you know, be in the forefront, to have a leg up when they come, when they go to the workforce, because coding is one of those industries now that that are giving a lot of people jobs. So we want to train our young people to have that opportunity. So we're doing that. We have a project called the social lens project, where where somebody that we know, a filmmaker, is gonna come and teach our young people to do projects in their communities, either by film or photography, something that they can, you know, show and showcase, or something that they feel that needs to be shown in our community. Because sometimes, you know, in a lot of media, they only put the negative. We wanna show the positive thing that's happening in our communities, not just the negative, you know, everything that, you know, we know what's happening. And we need to bring up the things that people don't see. And that's what the young people are going to do with the social lens project that we are putting together. And we are putting many different projects together for the young people, but we need a space to be able to do that. As things open back again, because things are normalizing, quote unquote. So we are trying to make sure that we keep the space and we provide services for the young people.
How can people help out, Hector? You know, I'm sorry to hear that the space facing, you know, possible closure at this time, but how can people help out and reach out and, you know, assist you in any way?
I mean, the best way is going to our website. If you go to www.1freedom.org, you can find all the information you need. How can young people become activists for One Freedom? How can you donate and help One Freedom stay in the space that we are in? Because right now we are in the heart of the South Bronx. We are between the Grand Concourse and Webster. So we have a lot of different people, diverse community in this area that is going through it because of the pandemic. Before the pandemic they were going through it, but now it's more not like it's what's the word I'm looking for?
It's like exacerbated, like it,
yeah. It just, you know, la pusieron más grande. I don't know
have started, you know, to expand, and a lot of issues have started. And one of those issues that you brought up is food insecurity, of course, which has affected the community in the Bronx even before the pandemic, you know. So if you can share how One Freedom seeks to address and dismantle the issue by also having community fridges, can you tell me a little bit more about that?
Yeah, so we, last year, when de Blasio put out a statement that they were going to cancel summer youth employment, we started fundraising money so we can provide our own program. Then, you know, they opened summer youth employment again virtually, but it was limited sitting. So we decided to do it ourselves. So we had our own program. We hired in from July to the end of August, we hired about 10 young people that we fundraise money out of our own, you know, out of our own hustle. We fundraise this money to hire this 10 young people so they can create community projects. Wow. And we were teaching them about mutual aid. One of the main things that we were doing was mutual aid and the conversation about community fridges, because back in the summertime, that's when they were popping up. There were only like about 20 something throughout the city when we put our first one, because our fridge in front of our office in 237 in McClelland, in front of our office, they are, it's the first one in the South Bronx. So that was all done by the young people and the work that they put in for 2 months to create a project. So we put out the first one. Then we put out one on 155th and Broadway. That's the Sugar Hill Community Fridge. Right now, that one is community run. And that's the purpose of the fridges, that it should be community run. We can help out to build it. But at the end of the day, we want the community to take ownership of that, right? So the 155th and Broadway, the Sugar Hill Community Fridge, is run by the community now. And then we have one in Frederick Douglass Housing. That's in 101st and Columbus, in Manhattan. So that one is run by our young people. There was a young lady that lived in the projects right there in Douglass Housing, and she said, "I wanna get a fridge here," and she got a fridge. So right now it's called the Ujamaa Fridge. If people want to check it out, you in the area, go and donate to the Ujamaa Fridge. And now on Saturday we open our fourth one, the Mecca Fridge. In collaboration with the Bronx Community Alliance and Rep for Bronx. And those are organizations that's doing a lot of work in the community. So we decided to partner up in that community that needed it. Because, you know, if you walk around there, you can see that people need. And it's a shame that we have to, you know, the conversation for us is, for us, the fridges is a band-aid. A bandit to the larger problem. It's, the conversation is, why do we need a fridge when New York City is one of the richest cities? What is the richest city in the world? Like, that's where the money moves. That's where Wall Street is. So why do people in our community need to like resort to ourselves to put up a fridge so we can feed ourselves when there's so much money moving here? So that's the conversation that those fridges bring. That's the conversation that we want to bring out. It's not just, it's cool to have a fridge. It's nice. But if somebody don't have a house to cook the food that they take out of the fridge, it makes no sense. Sometimes I'm driving when I'm picking up boxes to feed the fridges. And I see somebody that, you know, that is asking for change. And I say, I don't got money, but I got a box. And they tell me, well, I live in a shelter. I get robbed if I bring that kind of box, or I don't have no place to put it. So people need homes. So it's great that we can, that it's cool that we're providing food, but there's bigger issues that we need to address. And that's what One Freedom is doing.
Right. I love that. I wish we had more time, Hector, but we have to go. We ran out of time. Again, how can people stay in touch and continue, you know, learning about your important work at One Freedom? Just some
Social media. You can visit us on Instagram at One Freedom, the number 4, all. That's on all our social media. And then our website, www.1freedom.org, and you can find all our information, donate. So please, thank you so much for having me.
Thank you again. Hector Gerardo is the founder and executive director of One Freedom for All. We'll be right back.
We built a media network for you.
BronxNet TV.
Come learn in your new state-of-the-art studios at Lehman College.
At Mercy College.
And coming soon to the South Bronx in the Hub.
Inspire with your stories, culture, history.
Your Bronx on BronxNet.
Engage with us.
Connect with us at your channels and at BronxNet.tv.
Learn. Engage. Inspire. BronxNet TV.
From the Bronx
to the world.
BronxNet.
Welcome back. Art Time is an art tutorial docuseries about the lives of Bronx artists here on BronxNet. In collaboration with BX Arts Factory, the series features small glimpses of the artist's work through interactive projects that you can do at home. Joining us now to share more is Laura Álvarez, co-founder of BX Arts Factory. Welcome, Laura.
Hey, thank you for having me here.
Of course. So for those of us who haven't seen the series yet, can you just tell us a little bit more about BX Arts Factory's Art Time series here on BronxNet?
Yes. So we wanted to do something showcasing Bronx artists, and we thought it was a great idea to showcase them in a type of like a conversation with themselves about art and the Bronx and how they relate to those two things and how they became artists. We believe like everyone is an artist in BxArts Factory, and a lot of people, they are not sure how to make that step and go one step further in their careers as an artist. And you, through this docuseries, you can see that anyone and any way, it is completely random, you can become an artist. You don't have to go to art school necessarily. It's just like something fluid that happens. And we had that idea earlier on, but there was too many things going on. So once the pandemic started, we found the time, there was nothing else to do, to partner with BronxNet for this.
I've seen it, and it's so therapeutic to see the artists just talk about their work and also relate it to the Bronx and like how you provide basically a list of items that we all need and we all have at home that we can just like come on and join you. So that, I think it's incredible and immersive and amazing that BX Arts Factory is doing this. How did the collaboration with BronxNet come to fruition when you decided to do the show?
Well, we've been doing a lot of things with BronxNet. 2 years ago, I did a big mural in the new place with some of our students from our program in CreateShare. We've done things in the past. We're always in your show because you're so amazing that you always invite us every time we have something going on. And we've talked about having a show and producing something with artists, but there was never the right time because there was so many things going on and we were so immersed in everything that's happening. And when we had to move virtually, not only because virtual is what is now because of the social distancing, but also because we lost our space during the pandemic, we thought, why not reaching out to BronxNet and see if we can do that project that we had in store and just do it now. And that's how it happened.
And here we are today. So happy to be in collaboration always with BX Arts Factory and the incredible work that you and all the artists there have committed to do, even throughout the pandemic. I know it's been really, really hard and challenging for artists all throughout our borough, you know, to show their work. And this is just another stepping stone in our community. So again, yeah, thank you for it. I wanted to ask Laura, there's a new episode coming. Is it monthly that episodes come?
Yes. Okay. Yes. So far, we've recorded 10 episodes. Okay. Three of them were premiered back in 2020. Okay. And the seven that is left are going to go this year. So we're going to have 7 months. Yeah. And this one that it comes up in March is my episode.
What are we going to learn? What are we going to learn to make in this episode? Please tell us.
So it's based on the work that I've been doing in printmaking and also in patterns, in repetition, and where we're going to be creating some potato carved stamps.
Oh, I need more info, but I guess we can just tune in and find out when we tune in, right?
Yeah. Yes.
And can you share some of the past episodes and tell us about how the artists are selected to be featured on the show? You know, if there's an artist tuning in, do they have an opportunity to submit their work to BX Arts Factory?
In the future, probably they will be. The way that we selected the artists were these past episodes was basically we were, because we had a space and we had an artist residency program, we had planned for April an artist residency with somebody that worked already previously with us. But that didn't happen because of the pandemic. So we took some of the people that applied for that residency, and their projects were kind of matching with what we were looking for, and we translated into that. Yeah, we tried to do that with all our programming. Like Radio Corner is kind of like unlocking the artist. The block party, we did it virtually. We've been trying to kind of morph from everything with people and everything in the community, that's who we are, into everything online.
Gotcha.
And that's how we use the residencies into the art time. And then after that, the rest of the artists is basically artists that we work with. A lot of artists that we know, they teach, it's like their everyday bread. And then they are artists too. But we wanted to kind of showcase those teaching artists, that they really work hard getting people to lose that stage fright to creating something. Yeah. and just showcasing them.
Got you. Thank you for sharing, Laura. And you know, the value of having a show like this is, of course, to showcase the incredible work of our local artists here in the Bronx in particular. Can you share more of the importance of sharing this platform, especially during these times, and what keeps the BX Arts Factory going?
The community keeps us going. And the artists that are so supportive all the time, every time we have a new project, they're in. And even now that we're trying to do everything on video, and it's been very hard for a lot of artists that they're not that tech savvy, and like trying to help them and getting that next step for their careers, because right now everybody needs it. Yeah. So I don't know, I think it's very important to support each other. And that's why we are here. We are here to support artists. We created a COVID-19 relief grant for artists. We've been trying to help as much as we can, because we are a volunteer-led organization. We are all volunteers when we work at the organization in any position, but we only pay the artists. Right. So we always want to make sure that the artists have their money to keep creating and to survive, because it's not easy.
Yeah, as we all, you know, seen and experienced throughout the pandemic, it's been really, really tough, especially for artists and creators. Mm-hmm. But the motivation to create and to continue creating is still there. And that is the most important thing. Art in our lives is one of the most important things to keep us moving forward in our community. So, you know, it's always appreciated. Another amazing thing that BX Arts Factory has is the Studio 13 Gallery. And you have an exhibition on display for Women's History Month. Laura, can you tell us a little bit more about it? You are the curator of this exhibition, So you can share more.
Yes. So as COVID-19 hit, Aida Miró, she's another artist from Spain. We're both from Spain. And she's a graffiti artist and muralist. She had done a mural the year before that in the Bronx, honoring women. And she had another grant for another mural, but she couldn't do it. So one day we met in the park, and I was like, okay, how we can make this happen? Because the money is there and we need to use it. And we need to create something that honors women and that enhances all the work that women do in the Bronx. So we decided to go with the videos, and it's 13 videos, like an interview kind of thing, between 10 and 12 minutes each. And they're all women related to the Bronx, that they do a lot of community work, and they some of them born and raised here, some of them like me, that you feel that Bronx is your home. Yeah. And from that, she created a portrait of each of the women. And now it's on display in the Studio 13 Gallery. We're keeping that name, because that was the name that we had when we had a space. we're like, we'll keep it Studio 13 for now. And we have the opening March 11th, and then the closing April 2nd. And it's going to be online.
So everything is virtual. We go on and we check out the videos and everything through the website, through the Bronx Arts website.
Yes, bxartsfactory.org, and you can check all the pictures, all the paintings, details of the paintings, and then we have also the videos.
Gotcha. Oops, I said Bronx Art Space by mistake. I meant BX Arts Factory. I'm sorry, Laura.
It's okay. You
know, so many different organizations that are doing incredible work. How can I keep up? Laura, so the mural that Ida Mural created, that's actually on 145th Street, right? I remember that that went up. It's beautiful, so colorful, and it's still up there, right?
Yes, it's still there.
Nice. So some of the women that are being portrayed are also part of the mural series, or are they all different women now this time around?
I think one of them, she recreated in the portraits, but the rest are all new. Basically, like the BxArts Factory core, and then other women that has to do with art life and different parts of the Bronx.
I love it. Well, let's invite our folks to view the show and also tune into Art Time. Tell us more information, Laura, on how people can view Art Time and also check out Studio 13, the gallery online.
Yes, if you go to bxartsfactory.org, you have the information for the gallery, and I believe you have the links also for the Art Time episodes. But they're all in the BronxNet website. And I think we're airing the third Saturday of the month. Mm-hmm. So every month we'll have a different episode. And then at the end, we'll have a little surprise of a marathon.
Better that we gotta tune in. All right, thank you again, Laura, for your time and for sharing. One more thing, just a message to artists and creators out there in the Bronx, how to upkeep and keep creating, and just a wonderful message that you can share with Bronxites at this time.
Yeah, I think art for me is a therapy. So anytime I'm creating something, I am putting my soul in it, and I think that's what keeps me doing even more, because we can let this situation get to us to the point that we lose our creativity, because that will really sink us. So we need to keep our hopes high and keep creating.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, Laura, again for your time, and thank you for joining.
Thank you.
Always a pleasure having you. Laura Álvarez is a BX Arts Factory co-founder, and you can check out the show here on Art Time on BronxNet every first Saturday of the month. Start creating and keep creating in the Bronx, and tune in. That's all for our show today. I'm your host, Sonyi Lopez, wishing you and your family safety and wellness now and always. Take care.